Happy Thanksgiving and welcome to a special holiday edition of Mark's Madness, joined as always by Mark Miller. I'm Matt Finkel and we're here to break down the regional final football games from the past weekend and preview the state semifinals. And we've got five area teams still competing. Let's begin by breaking down those regional finals. In Division 3, Wapak Trotwood, we were looking forward to this one for a while. Saw it on the radar as a potential regional final weeks ago. We got it, and the Rams delivered big time.
Yeah, they're really good. I mean, they're not there for by accident, you know, and Wapak knew that. And Wapak's really good. Now, the score was got a little out of whack, but, boy, you know, you got to hand it to Trotwood. They've got skill. We had heard coming down as they started to get into the playoffs how skilled they were, and they lose a great quarterback to Huber Heights Wayne, transferred out last year. And now they get this sophomore running back that's just a wee little dude, but my goodness gracious, 300 yards in three straight games now or something like that. He's phenomenal. People that I've talked to that saw him run say they've not seen anything as quick as him in a long time.
Crazy speed as Trotwood gets the win 33-3, the final score. Hargrove finished with 323 yards and three touchdowns. It's his fourth plus 300-yard rushing game in his last five, and as you mentioned, wow. Just a sophomore. Yeah. So. You know, Wapak ran into a very good team in Trotwood, who's right. Now defeated two WBL teams in their route to the state semis, and a great season for Wapak ends again in the
12-1,
regional
final. And the further you go into playoffs, the more it hurts, so I'm sure they're stinging down there, and to lose to the same team, that's a bad deal too. But you know what? What a fabulous season Travis Moyer and those guys had. Dominated, undefeated again, won the WBL. They'll be really proud of this in years to come.
Those seniors, when they look back on this year, should be only positive memories for them. All right, how about Division 5, Coldwater, another big win, 31-13 over Brookville. It's their eighth straight regional title.
That's amazing, isn't it? And they're up to their old tricks. You know, they're running it and they're throwing it with great efficiency, not making very many mistakes. And you know, they're just quick and they play hard. And you take away Malave Bettinger, and they don't have a really big guy that runs out there, and they just all play hard. They're just really good.
Jack Hemmelgarn's stats feel like they're the same week to week. This week it was 14 of 21, 207 yards, two scores. Aaron Harlemard had five catches, 110 yards.
Harlemard's turned into the guy, you know, the go-to guy. And you know, he's had some big games coming down the stretch.
With all the success that Coldwater has had in recent years, Chip Otten says they remain motivated by getting back each year with a different group of guys.
We talk about it a little bit, about keeping, we call it the eyes on the prize. They've been pretty good about that all year. You know, we have a phrase, fast, loose, and focused. And they've been able to pretty much be ready on Friday nights. You know, most of our guys are seniors, so they've been through it enough that they know, you know, when it's time to focus, it's time to focus. But also, we don't want them so tight, so focused that they don't play and just go let their abilities take over.
It's tradition around here to, you know, go far. My brothers, they all went to state. And then I just want to keep it alive, keep winning.
So very exciting time in Coldwater again. And, you know, it's tough to put into perspective what they've accomplished. But when you see Petey Post say that, you know, he watched his brothers do it and now it's his turn, it really is that legacy that just builds on each other.
It is. You know, growing up, those are the kids that watched those guys play. Those were their heroes, and they wanted to be just like them. And in Coldwater, that means win a state championship. I mean, there's not a lot of leeway there, but they're up against a good team. There's no doubt. Wheelersburg is there, 13-0, two 13-0 teams. That's pretty cool. But they like Coldwater, are really good in baseball every year, too.
They played each other in baseball,
State semis last year. Of course, Coldwater won it all the year before. This should be a good game, but look at the schedules. Wheelersburg is not playing Marion Local and Minster and Fort Recovery like the Cavs do every
Something
every
that
year.
Stood out to me, I think their margin of victory was 33 points on average was Wheelersburg. Yeah. But Coldwater has that, too. And like you said, their schedule is a little tougher. So.
Right. Yeah.
All right, well, we'll see how that one plays out. It's a game you'll be able to see on WOSN. But for now, let's take a quick break here on Mark's Madness, and we'll be back to break down Division 6 and 7. Back here on Mark's Madness, talking high school football as we get you ready for the state semifinals. And Mark, let's continue breaking down the regional finals game you were at on Saturday. It was Mechanicsburg, Marion Local, and Flyers get the win 9-7.
Yeah, 9-7, you think, that's boring. This was not a boring football game. This was a really competitive, hard-hitting, close the whole way football game. The weather probably kept the score down a little bit. It was brutal, but the kids played through it, And it ended up being a fabulous game, and what a win. Marion Local figuring out a way to get it done again with a field goal.
Yep, a field, just their second field goal that they've kicked all season long. And when you have a final score like 9-7, a lot of defense. So why don't we take a look at a play? And first what we're going to do is we're going to take a look at a play that Mechanicsburg ran against Jefferson the week before and see how it went for a touchdown. And then we'll show you how Marion Local defended that play.
Well, they run it so much and so well with Caleb Romero, the quarterback. When he drops, takes that shotgun snap and runs up into the line of scrimmage, everybody thinks run. Then he steps back and he throws it deep. And you saw that one went for almost 90 yards. He's going to do the same thing against Marion Local. He wants to draw him up, but look at all the blue shirts back there. There's lots of defenders. They were coached. They looked at it on film. They did not get fooled. And here it is again. You can see where he wants to make everybody think run and then drop back and throw it over the top. But he did not get the defender behind, or his receiver behind the defenders, and that's a great play right there.
Interesting to see that that was their first pass of the game for Mechanicsburg. There was 3 minutes left on the clock, so the weather definitely factoring into that.
And it's not like they can't throw it. They threw it for over 1,500 yards, completing 70% on the year. That kid's really, really good. They just chose not to throw it that night. Weather had a lot to do with that.
So the Flyers get it done again, and they're now looking for their fifth straight state title, which sounds absurd to say. That would tie for most all-time in Ohio. And for Coach Goodwin, it's different a little bit every year, even though the results are the same.
The coaches and I were just talking about this. I think the biggest thing for us is, for the coaches, we want to win because we want two more weeks with these kids. You know, that means more to us than anything. You know, we just like being around the kids. We like practicing. We like everything. So, you know, we don't want to cut short.
Just like all the other teams before me, all the other seniors before me, you know. I mean, every kid grows up wanting to win that state championship, and us to be that blessed to win five in a row, you know, it feels good to be a senior to have that. It would feel good to be a senior and have that fourth ring.
So Schwederman, another senior who could win four state titles in his 4 years. The class before him did it. And like I said, you know, the results are the same, but every experience, every year takes on its own feel, and it's its own thing, right?
Yeah, especially for the seniors. They want to win their senior year. You know, winning as an underclassman is pretty cool, but when you're a senior, it's your team, and you don't want to have that on your record that you didn't get it done that year. So, yeah, the seniors turn into great leaders because they want that championship.
So now the Flyers will take on Tenora, who defeated Van Buren 44-14. And this game, the Rams got off to a perfect start, pretty much. It was a turnover on the first play from scrimmage for Van Buren. And then they went right in a couple plays later, and they were up 28-0 in the blink of an eye.
What Coldwater does every game, they get off to a fast start, and that's exactly what Tenora did, and they're good. You let a team like that get out to a lead, it's very difficult to close the gap and get back into the game, and it ends up 44-14. But how about Van Buren? 9-game win streak after starting 0-3. What a great year, deeper into the playoffs than they've ever been before. What a fabulous year for Van Buren, but Tenora's good. There's no doubt about it. They get there every year. They get deep into the playoffs, and this is no exception.
Definitely agree with what you said about the Black Knights, because like we've talked about a couple of times, 0-3, you could hang it up.
That's right.
And they
could have quit.
And they made history for their program. So congrats to Coach Schaup and the entire Van Buren community. But Tenora, too much on Saturday night in the snow, like Marion Local played in the snow, Tenora played in the snow. Riley Nagel, what a game. 30 rushes, 199 yards, 3 touchdowns. He got all 3 of those in the first quarter. So now Tenora plays Marion Local. Yeah. What do you see out of this game?
Well, it's going to be another good game, like a state semi should be. You know, Tenora plays a pretty good schedule. They're fairly local. They understand the Marion Local thing. I don't think that'll scare them off. But they're not going to have seen a defense like they're going to on this weekend with Marion Local. They played defense last week really, really well against a great offensive football team.
Seems cliche to repeat it, but defense does win championships and the better defense.
Especially in the bad weather, right?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. When we get cold and snow like we've had that Saturday, and who knows what it'll be this Saturday. Yeah. But Tenora and Marion Local will play for a chance to play in the Division 6 state finals, and you'll be able to watch it on WOSN. We need to take another break here on this special holiday edition of Mark's Madness, so grab some turkey and come right back. We're going to break down D7. On to Division 7 now, and some good games in D7 last week, starting with Macomb over Lucas, 36-6. It's their first Final Four appearance since 2012 for the Panthers.
Well, they won it all way back when, you know, so they're trying to get that done again. But, they were just a lot better than Lucas, you know, and they're playing well right now. And after that, you know, talk about a win streak. They lost the opener very close to Marion Local 24-22, and now they've won them all. So they're on a roll, and be a tough. They'll be a tough out for anybody.
Yeah, 12 straight wins, and the offensive line really set the tone in this game because they rushed for 5 scores and 3 touchdowns for the freshman Keegan Lowe.
Yeah, how about that? You know, to get a but we've heard all along from the very first game against Marion Local, they're big and strong on the line, and that's what they have been able to ride the whole year long, and the freshman's just reaping the benefit right now.
It must be exciting to be a freshman playing a regional final and score 3 touchdowns. Mm-hmm. So Macomb now will take on Fort Recovery. After the Indians knocked off Minster 33-21, Battle of MAC teams, Minster the defending state champs in Division 6, now playing in Division 7, and Fort Recovery able to beat them despite playing without their starting running back, Kyle Schwer, who was injured the prior week.
Isn't that hard to believe in a lower division? Because you don't have a lot of kids, you don't have a lot of depth, but they lose a really, really good running back in Schroer, and in steps Will Holman, and just has a great game. So, you know, credit to those guys, and Caleb Martin has stepped up, you know, throwing the ball extremely well, and he can run around a little bit too. This is a good team. You know, they beat Minster. That gives validation to anybody that thought they were the third of the MAC teams that were still in the playoffs. They're right there. They deserve to be where they're at, and they will also be a tough out, which makes this game really, really good, I think.
Yeah, going to be a really good game. And just to go back to our cliches, we were talking about defense wins championships. Third down is the most important down, right?
What
did Fort Recovery do on third down? Oh, they just went 14 of 20 on third down conversions.
Yeah, when you can extend drives and continue moving the ball down the field, that's huge, instead of turning it over on punts or downs.
So how about the season for Minster, graduating a good senior class, 19 of those seniors for the Wildcats, and including quarterback Josh Nixon. I know Coach Stokes just said they grinded it out week after week, and of course they didn't get the result, but nothing to hang your head about for Minster.
No, no. I mean, they play in the state's toughest conference, and they get into the playoffs, and they won it last year on a Cinderella ride. They kind of backed that up with another one. And those kids have a lot to be proud of. And they played really well. I mean, you know, I love watching Nixon play. He's got a live arm, man. As a quarterback, I love to watch guys that when it throws, it zips. You know, it leaves their arm almost like a rocket booster, you know. So they were fun to watch, and they deserve all the wins that they got. Fort Recovery just avenged that close season loss, you know. 14-12, they lost during the regular season. They got the one that counts, and they're still playing.
Very true. So the Indians moving on, and it's kind of new territory for the Fort Recovery community, which is generating a lot of excitement for Coach Niekamp and the players.
The community support's been amazing. We've got a lot of people who have supported us, you know, for the past 20 years through a lot of lean seasons, and those people have always been there. They've been helping out with boosters and stuff like that, and I know it's really important to them to see this turnaround. It's an important achievement for our kids, especially our older kids, because they've seen some of those tough years. And it's obviously special for me being a coach here for a long time, but I think really special for our community.
We put a lot of hard work in over all 4 years we've been here, and it's nice to see something paying off. And really just for the community, it's something for them to do between football and basketball season. Now they're pushing games back, and it'll be really nice to bring home a state championship.
Well, to get to week 15 for recovery, we'll have to beat Macomb. Who do you like in this game?
You know, I thought about this in long and hard. I'm not a great predictor, so, you know, I'm a little bit like Mike Greenberg. You don't want me to pick your team. But for some reason, Fort Recovery, they just seem to have it rolling. They're playing over injuries. They're playing through defending state champs. They're kind of doing their own little thing, and they're there. So, you know, it wouldn't surprise me no matter who wins, but I think Fort Recovery with the run-pass mix has it going.
Tough to pick against the MAC. They do still have 3 teams left competing for state titles in Divisions 5, 6, and 7. 3 of 5 area teams left that will play in the state semis, and we'll be able to show you a full game rebroadcast of all 5 of them. Friday, 11:30 p.m. on WOSN, Macomb versus Fort Recovery. Saturday at 7:30, catch the Coldwater versus Wheelersburg game. And then Saturday, 11:30 p.m., Tenora versus Marion Local. Looking forward to bringing all those to you. And, of course, we'll have highlights on the sports report both nights, Friday and Saturday at 10 p.m. Thank you so much, Mark Miller. Great job. As always, great job all season. Really appreciate it. Really enjoyed it. We need to take a break here right now. When we come back, I'll be joined by another Mark to talk some high school basketball. Welcome back to this holiday edition of Mark's Madness. And as promised, we've got a new Mark seated to my left. It is Mark Shine. And we're ready to talk high school basketball as the season tips off on Friday night. And Mark, I want to get started with an interesting scheduling note with the holidays falling on Fridays. We got Christmas Day, New Year's Day on Fridays this year. It's a jam-packed boys' schedule, isn't it?
Well, what it means, Matt, is you typically have 13 weekends to play your 22 games. But now you take out those two Friday nights of Christmas and New Year's. Now you've got 11 Friday nights. You're trying to play 22 games. I just happened to look at Minster's schedule today. Now, this doesn't include their Spencerville game, which has not been rescheduled yet, but they're going to open up the season. They're going to go Friday, Tuesday, Friday, Saturday, Monday, and then Wednesday, Monday, Wednesday. But by the time they get to January, they're playing five consecutive Friday and Saturday nights in a row. Now, obviously, Minster has some football success, but so have some of the other schools in the area. It's going to just be a jam-packed schedule. You throw a winter problem in it, like snow or something, and you lose a weekend. We could have some really serious scheduling issues this year.
It's absolutely going to be a grind for the boys' basketball season. And we know the boys' basketball season is one of the longer ones, you know, November to March, if you make it all the way to the end, like LCC did last year, second straight year reaching the state final. What are we looking at for the T-Birds going into this season?
Well, I think, first of all, Matt, they had to replace Jake Williams. And you look, well, he's just a big body inside. Well, he was more than that. He was an enforcer inside. He could rebound. He could score a little bit. I think they need to find a little bit of size and strength inside. If they do that, the Thunderbirds are really good because you got Trey Cobbs, you got Dantez Walton, Josh Dixon, who I think is one of the more underrated point guards in the area because other people tend to overshadow him. Other experienced players, O'Connor and Taflinger, it could be a very good year for Lima Central Catholic.
Coach Kale, very excited about the guys returning. And I was at Dantez Walton's signing going to Northern Kentucky. And some of these guys got bigger, which you expect to see. But, right. You know, I haven't seen them in a couple of months. So it's surprising to see the size on Dixon and Cobbs and, you know, just broader.
Physical maturity. And that will help, of course, because the high school basketball game, much like the college game, has gotten that way. I think the other thing, Coach Kale was able to do this last year without playing in a conference. Are they going to be able to maintain a focus throughout the season and continue to get better? Coach Akil was able to accomplish that with his team last year. We'll see if he can do it again.
Speaking of maintaining a focus throughout the season, that's something that is essential to do in the Western Buckeye League. And Salina, the defending league champs, but they'll have a new coach this year.
They do. Jay Imwally, and he's like new to the program. Jay was kind of their defensive coordinator, to use a football term, for a lengthy time period. And he's experienced. He knows the program. He's been there for a very long time. He'll do a very good job. Yes, it's different being in the main chair, but Jay will be just fine. His problem is everybody graduated but Caleb Hoying, and he's got a lot of people to replace.
How about Defiance, the defending state champs in Division II?
Yeah, how about that? Kirk Lehman, what a job he did. I know when you talk about coaches, you look at one statistic, and that is how do they fare in games that are decided by 5 points or less? He was 4-0 in the tournament last year in games decided by 5 points or less. If you take his team a year ago, put him out on the basketball court, that's the best choose up teams with the other starters there for the other three teams. His kids aren't getting picked very often in that top group, but he did a tremendous job of managing the basketball game. His team was very successful.
The definition of a team.
Absolutely.
In every sense of the word.
And well coached. You know, sometimes we use that term, are you a coach or are you a caretaker? He's a coach. He's not just saying, guys, the bus leaves tomorrow at 3:30, let's get on it. He's able to coach his team, his ability to strategize and maintain control of the game and pace and so on, when to call timeout, when to call certain play. He was outstanding last year.
Anybody else you're looking at in the Western Buckeye League? You'll get a look at Elida and Bath in the tip-off tournament.
That's right. We get to see both of those in the tip-off this weekend, as we always do. Yeah, I think those two teams are teams that could be okay. I think Bath might be a sleeper this year. They have Andrew Renner back, who could be one of the top five or should be one of the top five players in the conference. He's there. He's got a lot of experienced guys around with him. Sean Allen's in his second year of the program. So I think Bath might be a sleeper this year. Can they win the conference? I'm not sure about that, but they can be one of those teams that could be a factor. And never count Ottawa Glandorf out. They're always in there somewhere in the mix.
St. Mary's also with a new head coach this year as well. Let's go to the NWC now, because the NWC was very interesting last year with Spencerville winning the league, and they're returning the majority of their guys in Zach Goki, Mason Nurse, Dakota Pritchard.
Yeah, they are. And of course, they're going to be the favorite in that conference, I would imagine. But they certainly have the experience back with Pritchard and Nurse and Mason Nurse, as you said. Goki's got a foot problem coming out of football. We'll see how quickly he gets through that. But they have, and the Croft twins inside, don't forget about the size they can bring as well. So Spencerville should be pretty good. I think the dark horse in that conference might well be Lincoln View. They've got size inside. They know how to use them. Brett Hammonds does a good job with his guard play. If they get consistent guard play, Lincoln View could be the surprise in the conference.
And how about Delphus Jefferson? Trey Smith going to have a chance maybe at crossing the 2,000-point mark for his career.
Trey Smith averaged 26.6 points per game a year ago. But let's don't forget they've got a point guard, too. Jay Stockwell averaged better than 14 points a game. You put run two guys out there like that, who can score roughly 40 to 45 points per game. You mix in some players around with them, they'll be very dangerous offensively. Coach Smith has a good team as well.
All right, how about the track? Lima Senior, a lot of talent on this team. Is it going to lead to a state run?
That's a good question, because that's the question we've all been waiting to answer, and we're going to see. But they're going to be very talented at Lima Senior. Obviously, it starts with Xavier Simpson. Then you got Rico Stafford, Ruben Flowers, those guys. I think the player they forget about is Jalen Thomas. We know how good of a football player he was. He's a rugged, physical player. He averaged better than 10 points a game last year. He can rebound. He can shoot the three. Don't forget about him. And if Upshaw comes around the middle, he's their 6'7 young man. If he comes around the middle to give him some little extra size, and the way Coach Simpson's now in his second year, and players understand him and the whole situation, the Spartans could be very, very good.
Yeah, Upshaw got some time as a freshman last year, so looking for him to help that team. And, of course, you've got Xavier Simpson going to University of Michigan, big offseason signing, the announcement and everything. And I know he can't wait to take the court. We can't wait to watch him.
Absolutely. And the word is his shooting's gotten better. He's always been able to take the ball to basket well and distribute it well, that his shooting's gotten better. And if that's the case, that obviously makes him really good. Obviously, Toledo St. John's, it's one of those teams, you know, you can use all the cliches you want. They don't rebuild, they reload and all those types of things. But St. John's with Ed Heinschel, they always put a good product out. And once again, I would think those would be the two best teams in the conference.
All right, great stuff, Mark. We're going to take a quick break here on Mark's Madness. When we return, we're going to continue breaking down the conferences, getting you ready for the boys basketball season. Welcome back. Matt Finkel alongside Mark Schein. We're previewing the boys' basketball season, and let's continue with the Blanchard Valley Conference. Very competitive last season. Seven teams finished over 500 overall.
Well, I think the real difference in the conference was Liberty Benton didn't dominate it, and when that didn't happen, other schools were able to step in and perform well. There's a lot of good athletes in the conference. There is not a clear-cut favorite this year. Liberty Benton should be good again, but so will a lot of other teams in that conference.
Looking forward to seeing how that one plays out. How about the MAC? Most of the league... Still focused on football, honestly, with the three teams still going. But this league has a lot of talented basketball players, too, and they're just going to get a late start.
Well, that's true. And, of course, Matt, what we have to look at with that particular conference is look at all the guys who left. Ryan Bruns left. Kyle Kanapke left. Carson Monger left. Stommen left. Mike Sell left. Kyle Aarons went to Michigan State.
Division I talent all over the place.
The talent was outstanding. They've all graduated now and for the most part have moved on to their college programs as well. So I think the MAC is a very unknown conference right now just because of all the great talent who's left. Who's going to step up and fill those particular roles?
Like the BVC, the MAC had a lot of teams over 500 overall. Six teams, St. Henry, Marion Local, New Bremen, St. John's, Coldwater, Versailles, and a lot of those teams have the guys that you just mentioned that graduated. So
we'll see
if they're what's coming up under behind them.
I saw Minster at a scrimmage, and I understand they were without 17 players. If you count freshmen, JV, varsity, they were missing 17 players, and they still played very well. Mike Lee might well have a very good team at Minster that might be nobody's going to talk about very much, but then they're going to get caught in that schedule situation we talked about earlier and how they're able to compete with that throughout the winter season.
How about the NWCC, Mark Perry, the defending champs, but they graduated their leading scorer, Jared Poling.
They did, but they've got two excellent guards back, one of whom is Lane Harvey, who may well be one of the best point guards in our area. And sometime, Matt, we ought to do a show just on how talented the point guards are in our area this year because there's going to be a bunch of them again. Lane Harvey averaged 17.4 a year ago. He's got Plumrie Gardner back with him, so he's got two good running mates. Matt Tabor loves that pressure defense and get out and run. He's got players that can do that this year. They'll probably be the favorite again in the conference.
Hopefully in a little while we will be able to examine all the point guards in the area. That's something we wanted to do last year,
right.
And we just got so caught up in everything. We're going to try to do that this year for sure. How about the PCL?
PCL, wide open race. I think Miller City graduated so many players. We're not sure exactly what they have back. We know Quartercrats up at Kaleida always puts a good product out there. Continental is better this year than they have been recently and with Coach Brown and what they're doing. So we'll have to see how that plays out. But that, again, that's a conference that appears to be wide open.
How about the Shelby County League?
Shelby County League. Rushi won it last year, of course, but they graduated 10 seniors. So we're not sure exactly what Rushi's going to have this year. Fort Laramie was very young last year. They've got a lot of guys back in Jackson Center, and Scott Elkert always does a good job there. Probably Jackson and Fort Laramie at the top of the conference.
All right, putting you on the spot here. I know it's 4 months away, but what are your predictions for March? Are we going to have a state champion this year?
Well, that's obviously an interesting question because there's so many things that take place, the dynamics of the sport. Do your players stay healthy? Do they stay focused? Do they stay together? All those types of things. And who's still fresh when you get to March? Who still wants to play? Because sometimes the season gets to be such a grind that you kind of wear people out of gas. Obviously, the Spartans have a tremendous chance. So does Lima Central Catholic. We could have two teams of that caliber in our region that could go to state tournament.
All right. We'll remember it in a couple of months. Mark Schein will be on the call for the Elida tip-off on Saturday. We'll also have action from the tip-off for you on Friday to go along with a couple of other games, including St. Henry Spencerville and Continental versus Temple Christian. You can check the website, WOSN.TV, for the full boys basketball rebroadcast schedule as season tips off this week. Should be fun. Thanks a lot, Mark. Yep. And thank you very much for joining us on this special edition of Mark's Madness. Happy Thanksgiving, and we'll see you this weekend.